a convert's complete change. Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, God is the source of love. Let me say that again in case you missed the intro of our message today. I need to tell you, God is the source of love. Jesus is the proof of love, and believers must be the agent of love in this world. This biblically accurate statement must be the standard for our living. Both within and outside of the church, we need to hold fast to the principle that God is the source of love, Jesus is the proof of love, and we as believers changed, walking in the newness of God. We are the agents of love in this world. We must show love to the lost in order to guide them with the gospel. But we must also share love with each other in order to encourage one another to keep the faith. God has done his part. Jesus is doing his part. And the question is, my brothers and sisters, are you doing your part? The love expressions moves what's in our heart and minds to how we speak, how we serve, and how we suffer, both for the good of others and to the glory of God. And as Paul, brothers and sisters, continues to drive this point home over the entire letter of this young fledging church, I'm convinced we need daily reminders and challenges to present ourselves in a way that pleases our God. There are many brothers and sisters who profess the faith, but far few actual possessors of the faith. I don't know who this message is for, but this is not something we should take lightly, brothers and sisters, or even without consideration. As children of God, we have an obligation to present ourselves pleasing unto God every day in every situation. We may fail, brothers and sisters, to realize it, but the world around is watching us. I need to say, we think that we are getting away, but I need to tell you, if we have ever confessed that God is the head of our life, and we ever confess that God is leading us, it then shines a spotlight on us as believers, and the world is now watching us to see whether or not we're actually walking in the light of the Lord. They heard many, they've heard of all of us who have professed Christ, only to see their actions betray their words. The world is looking for those who are real. We have the privilege and the obligation to present our faith to this world. And I don't know who I'm talking to today, but I'm wondering, is there anybody that has a made up mind that if for God you live and for God you die, and every step of the way, every opportunity you get, you're going to let the world know that you're on the Lord's side, despite what's going on around you, despite what's happening in our world? You're not going to sway to the other side, but you're going to continue to hold on to God's unchanging hand and let the world know that you're on the Lord's side. As Christians, it is our duty, yes it is, to walk circumspectly before God and man. I would like to consider this morning the expressions of our faith as we display as converts, as we walk as one who is walking out of the darkness and now walking in the light. We should be displaying our strong faith and a concrete conversion. We are keeping it 100 that we have made a complete change from the old man now to the new man. This is evident, brothers and sisters, when one is first of all inspired by our love. Listen, I need y'all to write that down. Inspired by our love. When folk can see Brother William, us not just talking the talk, but we are walking the walk. They don't see us just on Sunday morning with our hands raised up, but every day of our lives we are sharing the love of God. They are inspired by our love. Watch this. I'm in the text. Verse 9 gives way to, first of all, Paul's exhortation there to the church. Paul makes it known. He says, but concerning brotherly love, you have no need that I should write to you, for you yourselves are taught by God, watch this, to love one another. Listen, Paul speaks of the love they have for one another. Paul, he reveals that their love is already evident. They are expressing their love one for another such that he doesn't need really to mention it, but he humbly reminds and he encourages them to continue in that love. Can I throw this over into the pot while I'm stirring them? Those of us who are right with God do not need to be reminded, mind being challenged and encouraged to continue in the things that they're already doing. You don't mind folk telling you or reminding you that you ought to walk in the light of God because you already walking in that light. You don't get upset when folk tell you that you are examples or you the pace setters for those who are in the darkness and trying to find the light. You are the examples, and you don't mind people reminding you of how it is that God has picked you up and turned you around, and now the things that you used to do, you don't do no more. You don't mind people telling you that because you know that it was nobody, but don't miss this, but several times in the scripture, we find the word love translated from the Greek word agape. God's love, certainly we ought to desire to love as God loves, without boundaries or preconceived expectations. But this speaks of another type of love in which we are responsible. We are responsible for agape love, that God kind of love. But this phrase, brotherly love, is translated from the Greek word Philadelphia, where the city got its name from, the city of brotherly love. This is a love that binds our hearts together, develops a deep affection for the commitment to each other. It moves us to act on behalf of the welfare and the needs of others. That means we look like Jesus beyond all of their faults and failures, and we certainly consider their needs because we love them because of who they are, and they are a child of God. Let me hurry, because Paul moves from exhortation to instruction. Listen, he says, but concerning brotherly love, you have no need that I should write to you, for you yourselves are taught by God to love one another. Look at this instruction. They really didn't need, again, such a reminder, but Paul instructs them again anyway. He declares that even if he failed to encourage their love for one another, God himself teaches us that we ought to love each other. I'm hoping that you ain't hugging your pillars too hard right now and drifting away from us, because what the world needs now is love. I mean, when we are living in a world that's so divided, and even not just in folk in the worldly realm, but those of that are working even in the spiritual realm, we are so divided. We are so at odds with one another. What the world needs now is love. And our Lord, listen, Sister McCartney, declared that love for others was the second great commandment. I need to drive this point home. God said, Sister Anthony, that the second greatest commandment is that of love. Yes, the true believer have no problem in this area because we are all too familiar with what the scripture says in Matthew chapter number 22 and verse number 26. As a matter of fact, it is Jesus that is teaching this prominent lesson. He says, they ask him, teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law? And he responds there. He says, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and the greatest commandment. And here it is. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbors as yourself. On these two commandments hang all of the law and the law and the prophets. He says, brothers and sisters, if you in fact you want to really love and can walk in complete obedience with God, you got to first learn how to love. However, it doesn't hurt to remind and challenge us concerning our love for one another. We need to learn how to love in spite of. We need to learn how to look over those. Yeah, huh? My wife says something like this. You need to build a bridge and get over it. You need to learn how to love because Jesus loves us. And a matter of fact, he says something like this. He in another place, he says, if you don't learn how to forgive and how to forgive your brothers like I forgave you, my Father will not forgive you of your trespasses. And I keep telling folks over and over again, I got too much issues in my life. I've got to learn how to love. I've got to learn how to forgive. I've got to learn because I need God to forgive me. I need God to love me. I got too many hang-ups and hiccups in my life. So I'm looking for God to give me what's right for me, not mine. I need thee, God. Oh, yes, I do. I need thee. I got to hurry. Paul was inspired by the love expressed to these converts. That's why Paul gives this stern exhortation. And then he gives these instructions, but then he speaks to the expectation. Let me hump through this, and I promise you, I'll be out your way soon. Paul was not inspired of the Holy Spirit to pen these words just so that the Thessalonian believers would have something to read. No, he penned these words for their instruction and their exhortation. Paul and the Lord fully expected them to continue to grow in their love for one another. He expected them to feel the pain of others. He expected them to care for, y'all ain't getting this. He expected them to care for one another and come alongside the weak and the needy. Listen, brothers and sisters, this word is here for our admonition as well. We too, as believers, have the obligation and we are expected to love one another. Jesus speaks in John 15 and 12. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I loved you. Let me hurry, because not only do I see Paul was inspired by their love, but I see also the influence of their love. Write that down. That's good writing material. I keep reminding y'all that if I was listening to me, I'd be writing this stuff down. Listen, he was inspired, but now he was influenced. Look at, I'm in verse number 10. Verse 10 declares, and indeed you do so toward all the brethren who are in Macedonia. This lends, brothers and sisters, attention to a strong love. Watch this. As Paul examined, Mother Anthony, the church there in Thessalonica, he realized their love was not reserved or circumstantial. Listen, their love was not offered only to those who were in their immediate circle of influence. They weren't guilty of loving only those whom they were acquainted with or those who they held their particular view or understood what they were going through. Their love was expressed toward all. Y'all ain't getting this. You really want to keep it 100? Listen, You don't have those that you pick and choose that you're going to love and support. You don't have those you pick and choose that you're going to communicate with. You don't have those who you choose. You want to keep it 100. Paul says he identified their strong love because they didn't just talk to a clique or a certain crowd. They talked to all who were in Macedonia. They simply loved the church, whether they worshiped together or not. They were concerned about the well-being and the prosperity of all believers. Listen, we are sure in need of this today. I know we live in a body of flesh that is prone to hurt feelings and to get angry. I'm well aware that there are those who seem a bit harder to love than others, but we are all, yes, we are called to love those whom we are called to love those whom God has chosen for us to love. We are called to love all the brethren, even those with whom we may disagree or with from time to time. We still have to love them in spite of. Paul says, watch this, William. Paul says that this church love had influence because it was strong. But he encouraged them to be sure that their love was not just strong, but it was sufficient. He says, but we urge you, brethren, that you increase more and more. Paul was pleased with the love they had shown, but he prayed for their love to increase more and more. They loved one another in a way that was pleasing to the Lord, but even then, there was room for improvement. The word there, increase, has the idea of exceeding a fixed measure to abound and overflow. We could never be charged with loving too much. Can I tell y'all that again? You can never be charged with over loving somebody. Can I say it one more again? You can never be charged with doing too much when it comes to loving somebody. The Lord commanded us to love. May we seek, yes, brothers and sisters, to increase more and more in our love, to be sufficient in our love. I'm done. Paul encouraged this young church to remain steadfast in their faith. He urges them to let nothing, separate them from the love of God. He was inspired by their love. He acknowledged their influence, and finally, he speaks concerning their image. That's the last one. Listen, watch this. I'm in there in verse 11 and 12. He says that you also aspire to lead a quiet life, to mind your own business, and to work with your own hands as we commanded you, that you may walk properly toward those who are outside and that you may lack nothing. Here it is. Come get close to me, because dealing with this, with the display of our complete change as converts. Listen, William, Paul, he now shifts his focus from love we show to the lives we live. He speaks of several areas in which we are to reflect the Lord through our faith. We must reflect Christ as we, here it is, practice poise. We got to practice our poise, our posture, our demeanor. We got to practice that. Listen, he says, I'm in the text. I'm not making this up, y'all. I'm in the text. That you also aspire to lead a quiet life, to mind your own business. What a profound statement Paul makes to the church. He instructs them to be wise in their lives. They were to strive to lead a peaceable and quiet life, not running here and there, stirring up gossip and strife, but holding their peace and minding their own. I know it done got quiet on me wherever you are. One of the greatest hindrances to the church and our Christian faith is the presence of, Sister Anthony, of busybodies and gossipers. Some are quick to pick up the phone and gossip instead of taking the matter to the Lord in prayer. I wonder if our prayer life was as strong as our gossip life, how much better we would be. We do individuals that are involved nor the church of God any good by spreading rumors and gossiping about the next person. Much of our ammunition the world uses against the church is supplied by those of us in the church. We should practice at having poise. We should lead quiet lives and shut down the old rumor mill. I gotta hurry. Y'all really done got quiet on me now, but not only should we practice poise, but in another image, Paul suggests the converse display is that they should be seen pursuing production. Watch this. Paul says, I'm closing, my Anthony. I am. Paul says, and to work with your own hands as we command you. This is yet another simple truth found within the Bible. It is believed many in Paul's days were so excited about the Lord soon return that they sold all their goods and began to make preparation for that day. Now, I'm not teaching that we should not make preparations, y'all, and fully anticipate the Lord's coming, but we must continue to work while we are here. Many in that day had given away all that they had and no longer could provide for themselves. We must be looking for the Lord to come, but yet we must be sensible in the meantime. I'm troubled by those who are unwilling to do anything for themselves, seeking to take advantage of the hard work of others. I know some cannot help themselves, but if we are able, we are expected to work and to provide for our own needs. Laziness on the part of believers does nothing to advance the cause of Christ. What are you saying, Pastor, as I hurry to my seat? We need to get busy on the battlefield for the Lord. It's time out for people always having to prompt and prime you to do what God has blessed you to do. If he's gifted you with anything, you ought to be willing to serve so you can be like the old song, or like the old saints used to sing, may the work I've done speak for me. Paul says, practice poise, pursue production. And the text suggests that we display a positive profession. I'm done. That you may walk properly toward those who are outside. This may not be a shouting message, but he says that you may walk properly toward those who are on the outside. Well, let me tell you what this means, and then I'm out of here. The church was not to be deceptive or cunning in their dealings. They were to present themselves honest before all men. The principle has not changed, y'all. Much damage has been done to the church because of those who sought to take advantage of others. We must ensure that our motives are pure in all that we do. We need to be mindful of how we present ourselves to the world. Hard work and honesty will go a long way in reaching a man who needs the Lord. And this is all, brothers and sisters, I'm trying to tell you today, is that if we're going to be about our Father's business, we got to display a positive profession. If you said that if it's the Lord's side that you're on, people ought to see not only you walking, I said it earlier, walking the walk, but they ought to see you talking the talk. They ought to see you doing everything that is pleasing into our God. I'm done, brothers and sisters, but I need to tell you that if in fact you do all of these things, if we present this positive image to the world, Paul told this young fledging church there in Thessalonica, hold fast to what you're doing. Continue to show brotherly love towards one another. Continue to display, have an inspiring, outlook. And so that you will inspire not just me, but you'll inspire all that you come in contact with, that you are showing or sharing God's love. And not only will you inspire them, but you would also influence others, that because God has done so much for you, now that there won't be a secret what God can do, what he's done for others, he's able to do the same thing. I'm done. And not only are you inspiring others, not only will you influence others, but your image that you display will encourage others. It will encourage them that, yeah, God is faithful, and God is able to do what no other power is able to do. And I don't know who I'm talking to today, but Paul says you ought to have, when you do these things, God will bless you with a plentiful possession, that God will make sure that every last one of your needs are met. I don't know. I don't want to sound like a prosperity preacher, but it is true that whenever we do what God has asked us to do, whenever we learn how to love like God has asked us to love, when we turn from our wicked ways, God will certainly bless us as he said he would. He will make sure that every one of my needs are supplied. And I don't know who I'm talking to today. Maybe you are a recent convert, but I need to tell you that if you are yet holding on to God's unchanging hand, that you need to display the godly experience in your life, that God is better than what the world can offer to you. You ought to trust and never doubt. And I got good news to you. He will, won't he do it, y'all? He will surely bring you out. Now, what is the best, but what is the thing you're trying to say the most? Well, I'm love on one another. Can I close up when I tell you this? Paul said in another place that if in fact you're going to have this love thing down, if you're going to really get this love thing in your spirit, you got to learn how to really love. He says, though you speak in tongues, though you have the gift to discernment, though you have the gift to treat every man right, he says, if you have all of these things and you don't have love, you're just sounding brass and a tinkling cymbal. I'm just trying to tell somebody today, as I sign off, learn how to love like God loved. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes on him shall not perish but have everlasting life. You ought to love like God loved, but then you ought to love like Jesus loved. Jesus loved us so much that he took your sins and my sins and went to a hill called Calvary, and he died. Yes, he did. He died on Calvary's cross with your sins and my sins. He hung his head in the lock of his shoulder, gave up the ghost, declared it was finished, and he died. Yes, he did, but that's not how the story ends. 3 days later, he rose again. You want to know what love is? They stretched him high. They stretched him wide. They hung his head. For me, he died. That's love. Is there anybody here that's willing to love like God loved? In the all right, has he loved you? Has he picked you up? Has
Has he turned you around? Has he blessed you over and over again? If you don't mind, would you do me one favor as I close? Say, yeah!
We got to display a complete change, not just a partial change. And our complete change is that we love in spite of. Listen, brothers and sisters, let's pray. Eternal and everlasting God, our Father, we thank you for all that you do.